thank you so much for having me today. We haven't even started the interview and I'm already thrilled because your house and all of your art is so cool. Let's talk about your love of photography, when it began.
Well, I didn't start off in photography as early as a lot of people do. My background is in theater and dance and more performing arts. And I didn't take my first photography class until my senior year of undergrad, which is super late.
Yeah.
I mean, I get students who have been taking photos since they could hold a camera, and I'm very late to the game as far as that goes. But I took this photography class as an elective my senior year of undergrad, and it changed my life. I immediately decided that my degree was going to go unused. I did finish it. You know, it makes my dad happy. I did finish that degree, but I spent the next 2 years building a portfolio, and I went to grad school for photography. Early on, I thought I might want to teach, and so when I went to grad school, that was my intent. My intent was to teach.
So you went to grad school. After grad school, what was the next step?
Fort Wayne was my next step. I went to grad school in Savannah, at Savannah College of Art and Design, and when I graduated, academic jobs are few and far between, so I cast the net wide and had to look up Fort Wayne on a map because I had no idea where that was.
My husband has the same story, yes. So you ended up here to teach at St. Francis.
Yes.
So how long have you been doing that?
This is will be my 16th year at St. Francis.
Do you love it?
I do. I mean, my students are amazing. I get to talk about what I love every day. Who gets to do that?
I get to talk to people.
Oh, right, fair.
So that's a close second. Tell me about your process, because your photographs are not just beautiful, but they're so interesting. How do you do it?
Well, I think, you know, when you approach art form in any regard, I think whether it's performing or visual, that there has to be meaning. Mm-hmm. You know, when we first learn how to make art, we make art about things that are pretty. You know, we draw, when we're kids, we draw flowers. And then what my students, when they first start making photographs, they gravitate toward what's pretty. And pretty is lovely, and we all recognize pretty. But for me, that's not enough. Mm. You know, I need to make art about something that means something to me. And so whether it's looking at my history and dealing with memory, dealing with beauty ideals, even more recently with just kind of dealing with the fact that I'm in Indiana, you know, those, it has to be meaningful. Mm-hmm. And for me, that leads to the work that you make.
So I spent hours on your website because you have so many examples of your work, and I'm really fascinated by the way you, I don't know if distort is the right word, but you use distortion in a lot of your images. How do you do that, and what brought you to that?
I do distort. Sometimes
it sounds negative,
no,
so I don't want to.
No, and I'm going to take that as a positive.
Okay, good.
But I do distort. You know, when I'm using my big camera, which is right over here, when I use my big camera.
Do you really use that?
I do. The way the view camera works, most cameras, it's parallel. So your picture plane and your receiving end, whether it's film or a sensor, are parallel to each other.
Uh-huh.
But with a view camera, I can shift that. We call it tilt shift. It's kind of where the Instagram filter comes from.
Oh.
But so I can move that to create distortion, because that particular body of work is about memory.
Yeah.
And it's based on my grandmothers, who both passed away from Alzheimer's related complications.
Mm.
The year I came to Fort Wayne, they both passed. And so that's been something that's really important to me. And, you know, we think about memory and our memories, and they're all distorted.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I first started making this work, I had family members tell me that I wasn't telling the story right, that that's not how it happened. And I don't care, because that's my memory.
Yes.
You know, and our memory is real, but it's given to us by photographs. You know, I often think that I don't remember things from my past, but I remember the photographs,
yes,
of that scene.
Yes.
And so it is about a distortion of memory, and also the idea of Alzheimer's and how it murders the memory.
Yes.
And so all of that distortion is part of it.
I loved that series because I lost two grandparents to Alzheimer's, and I kept thinking, I don't know if this is what Cara meant by this image, but this is how I feel about it.
Oh, that makes me very happy.
Which is so, yeah, what a beautiful experience. Tell me what else inspires you. There's memory and being in Indiana. What else comes into the mix?
Sure. My other largest body of work is about beauty ideals. You know, and I don't know if it's because I have a background in theater. because my weight has been an issue ever since my whole life, you know? And so those things, this idea of beauty and what we have to do for that, and the fact that some of it is thrust on us as women, but some of it we do to ourselves. Mm-hmm. You know, I will fully admit that I am part of my psychosis about that.
Yes.
And so that work uses a 19th century process called mordansage. And so what that does is I take black and white photographs, and then this process, it's an acid. So it allows me to lift up the black parts of the image and manipulate them and move them around so I can create these women that don't exist. You know, I can make their waist smaller, I can make their breasts larger, I can make their faces fall off.
Yes.
You know, I can do all those things. And part of it is beautiful. I think they're beautiful.
Yeah.
But they're also kind of grotesque. Uh-huh. And so that's kind of the battle of, you know, the love and the hate that you have with that.
Yes.
It also gives me an opportunity to hand paint them. And painting is not my happy place by any means. But it gives me an opportunity to get into the work. Mm. You know, photography can be a real sterile art form. You know, it's a very clean atmosphere. It's a very perfectionistic right. kind of approach.
Right.
And when I paint, you know, I paint with my hands. I don't paint properly. Mm. You know, I don't use the right brushes. I probably don't even use the right paint. But and I paint with my hands a lot. But I feel like I'm getting into that where I create the color, as opposed to in a photograph where the color is part of the film or part of the process. When people ask me to describe what kind of work I make, I often say I'm a little bit of a schizophrenic artist in that it's totally different. The 19th century work is completely different from my work about memory, which is completely different from the street photography that I do. So it's definitely driven by content, as opposed to I am a color photographer or I am a black and white photographer. It's definitely not driven by that.
Do you feel like you have to flex different artistic muscles depending on which style you're going for?
Absolutely. The work about my grandmothers is very performative. Whenever there's a figure, it's me. Mm-hmm. And it's not because I, you know, want to take pictures of myself, you know, but it's because I know what I'm thinking about. Mm-hmm. I tell my students all the time, when, you know, self-portrait is so valuable because you are available whenever you need you. Mm-hmm. And I learned that in school. While I was in college, I worked 2-3 jobs in order to be able to do that. And so often the only time I had to shoot was in the middle of the night. And, you know, you try to get some people to hang out with you then, not so great.
Right.
So I became, and, you know, again, history of theater.
Yeah.
There is a performative aspect of that kind of work, which is completely absent from my 19th century work. Mm-hmm. There's no, you know, I mean, clearly I'm in it, I made it, but I'm not physically in it.
Right.
So there is a separation of parts of creativity. It makes me feel a little bit like I'm still in the theater when I make that work. Because I'm, you know, becoming something,
sure.
someone.
Sure. What is the one thing you hope people take away from your work?
You know, with the Alzheimer's work, I have loved these conversations. You know, you mentioned seeing something in there. Mm-hmm. A couple of years ago, I did a show in an Alzheimer's care facility. Mm. It was in a wing that had not been opened yet. And so it was part of this kind of celebration of this new wing. And I cried with so many people that I never met before, mm-hmm. because they knew exactly what I was saying, because mm-hmm. they had gone through the same thing.
Yes.
And then other people didn't have any personal connection to that, but it reminded them of something from their childhood, or something that is familial. Mm-hmm. And I love the fact that even though they may not get exactly what I'm saying, they get something. Mm. And that feels pretty awesome.
Is there something that you can't teach your students that they just have to have? Is there an artist that either lives in you or doesn't?
I don't think that an artist has to live in you. I often have students who are not art majors, and they come into my class feeling like, well, I'm not an artist, so I'm not going to be good at this. Mm-hmm. And that's crazy, because you can be taught how to use the camera. You can be taught what composition is. You know, some people inherently just have a compositional eye and they don't have to think about it. It just happens. Mm-hmm. And other people have to practice. So that can all be taught. The technical side can all be taught. But what you really have to dig into is why. You know, everyone can make a pretty photo. You know, I tell my intro students, you know, my niece is a child. She knows what pretty is, mm-hmm. but she doesn't necessarily know what meaning is. Mm-hmm. you know, the difference between subject matter and content.
Yes.
And content is where we want to get.
Have you always had that knack for content, or did you have to sort of learn that it's about more than beauty?
I've always been drawn to meaning, even from the beginning. Mm-hmm. My undergrad degree is in English, so I was always reading and thinking and studying and writing. Mm-hmm. So when I got to taking photographs, it felt really natural. You know, there's this cheese ball adage about, you know, a picture's worth a thousand words, but it really, you know, I discovered that I could say a whole story in a single photograph. Mm-hmm. And that became really powerful.
What is the best part of the process for you?
I will always say the very first moment when I take a piece of paper off of the enlarger and put it in the chemicals and an image appears. Mm. That's the best. It is still, it's magic. Mm-hmm. It gives me goosebumps. I'm getting goosebumps now just talking about it. Every time I make a print, that magic does not go away.
Mm. I have said it how many times just during this interview, but this space, your space and the energy and the art is just so beautiful. I really appreciate you talking to me.
Thank you so much. This has been so fun.
Great. Cara, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Arts in Focus on PBS Fort Wayne is funded in part by The Hour Foundation and the Community Foundation of Greater Fort Wayne.